Don't be so nervous, everybody. Just relax and be comfortable. What I thought we should do today is have a talk. Because there are lots of things you may want to know and there are lots of things you may want to talk about. And let me say that there are no limits. Let's get it moving. I think that the topics on which we can talk are all quite obvious. Constitutionalism, the state of constitutionalism now, the negotiating process and what happened. There are all sorts of burning issues with young people saying that we sold out as far as the property clause is concerned. There are all sorts of issues about whether the government today is complying with the constitution. There are things in connection with Nkandla. There is, of course, the language policy. There is continued racial discrimination in our country, continued sex discrimination, and our attitude to gay and lesbian people needs a great deal to be desired. Most of our people are still poor. And of course, we have social and economic rights in our constitution, which the courts have tried to give meaning to, which many of you would know about. There is that area. You know that there is a fair labor practice provision in our constitution which tries to achieve a measure of fairness between capital and labor because of the belief of by the constitution makers that the right balance between capital and labor is essential to the survival of our society. You push it too much one way, you get yourself into trouble in one respect. You push it too much the other way, we get it into trouble at another level. And of course, there are those who say that the property clause in our constitution is a sellout to our new constitutional order. My contention is that it is the property clause is really a very, very well balanced clause in our constitution, which ought to stay and which ought to be well managed so as to ensure that some change that does take place in our property. And of course, our constitution has the affirmative action clause, which makes it quite clear that legislative and other measures aimed at advancing categories of persons or categories of persons disadvantaged by past discrimination may be taken to promote the achievement of equality. We know that dignity is very important in our constitutional order. And I suppose the most important question is how there is a disconnect between the constitution and what our people think, and how do we achieve it's obvious that what the constitution requires and what our society requires is different. Our constitution is the vision for the future, and there is a question which arises, which is how do you go about the achievement in a real way, the kind of society contemplated in the constitution. And related to that, there are important questions about what the role of lawyers are, what the role of students is. I'll be talking about that more this afternoon, but we can touch on that. And then the important issue is whether the law itself can achieve change or whether we need something else. How far have we come? Where are we? And what is the contribution that we can make towards the achievement of the kind of society that we would like in our constitution? And of course, we have freedom of association. We have a political system, which you might want to talk about, which may be problematic at the level that we have no constituency-based politicians as far as the national and provincial level of government is concerned. You may have some difficulties with that. You may want to talk about the public protector and where we think that is going and what the views are on Thuli Madonsela and what she can and could not do. You may want me to talk about the separation of powers. I mean, are the courts going too far in achieving, in interfering with executive action? Is it right to say that that it is wrong for courts to interfere when it is the decision of the executive committee. And what does our constitution mean for separation of powers? So I'll stop there, and you think about what interests you. I didn't want to make this a long speech, so you think about what interests you, and let's just see how we can talk to each other, okay? So, I think I have an assistant here who will point to whoever wants to say something. Quickly now, we don't want to waste time quietly. Let's go for it.
Yes.
Hi, Josh. My name is Fadman Bwitsa. I'm in my fourth year of studies now. So, the question I'm interested in is, so in Edmund Cameron's book, he writes a lot about, during the apartheid era, how activist lawyers also used the law to combat the regime. And there has been now since a development, but what we see currently in South Africa is that the courts have very much become a place for lawfare or political lawfare, if you will. So as you touched on with regard to separation of powers and to what extent can the courts affect the actions of the executive and the legislature and so on. So I'd be interested in your views on this development that increasingly political fights are playing themselves out in the court. So for example, the Minister of Finance's application and the review of the public protector report and etc.
Okay, so are others who are interested in this, do you want to expand the question a little, add to it, say anything more about it before I respond? I think it's an important question. There's enough of an interest in it, but let's see what anyone wants to add to it or say about it before I go. That's all, okay. So, right. So our constitution provides that it is supreme. But before that, we did not have the supremacy of the constitution. So law is quite an amazing weapon. It is an amazing weapon because it can be used in many, many different ways. So in the apartheid order, we used the law as a weapon to change society. And we were able to use it because even though all judges in those days were appointed by the National Party, the Minister of Justice of the National Party, in fact, they couldn't even in those days, like in these days, I mean, you must understand that the President appointed Chief Justice Mokgweng Mokgweng, who wrote quite a scathing judgment on Nkandla. Don't ever forget that it was the president who appointed him. And very often, these appointments go wrong because you can't predict how individuals are going to behave. It was so during apartheid, it is so now. So that 10% of the judges who the Nats appointed thinking they would be on their side ended up not being completely on their side because sometimes you have laws which even judges can't stand up to, regardless of the circumstances. So we very often, 10% of the time, had judges who could rule for us if it was possible to do so, depending on how imaginative the arguments were, and so on and so on. So there were many cases we challenged, every house arrest, we challenged every banning order, we challenged every detention. We challenged every criminal trial where an ANC person was on trial for terrorism action, the terrorism things. We challenged the Terrorism Act, the Internal Security Act, and so on. And I must tell you one thing, that sometimes even the very conservative judges get fed up with their own government if they go too far. So what courts don't like, and never like, because they are judges after all, they don't like being told that judges must not interfere with, judges have no power to do something. When there are laws which limit the powers of courts, then even the most government-supporting conservative judge won't like it. So we had a case, and the case is the State versus Paddy Carney, which you can look at some point, where Section 29 of the Internal Security Act provided that no court of law will have the power to pass judgment on any detention made pursuant to this section. One would have thought that was a closed deal, the Act said so quite clearly, and yet five conservative judges unanimously came to the conclusion that what this section meant was that no court of law would be able to pronounce on the validity of a detention in terms of the section. And so they said, but first, it has to be a detention in terms of the section. Because unless it is a detention in terms of the section, we are only disempowered if it is a detention in terms of the section. And therefore, we do have the power to find out whether it is a detention in terms of the section, which means they gave themselves a power to determine the validity of their detention. So that is how amazing the law is as a weapon. It is unpredictable, it is difficult, it is complicated. But in those days, the separation of powers was quite straightforward. The legislature made the law, the courts enforced the law, and the job of the court was only to interpret the law. So the only way you could go about it is get them to interpret it in a poor friendly way or in a democratically friendly way, and we succeeded with some of the judges. But still, the notion of the separation of powers was in a sense absolute. It was absolute in the sense that courts, in the theory, had no power to achieve justice. It had no power to determine whether laws were just or not. So that there were many, many unjust laws in our country, and courts simply enforced them, generally speaking, 90% of the courts, on the basis of an understanding that there is no bridge between law and justice in our country. The law is the law, and courts must enforce it. The difference now is that the law is not the law which courts have to enforce, come what may. Because as all of you should know, the Constitution makes it perfectly clear that all law or conduct must be consistent with the Constitution, and the Constitution must be obeyed. Section 2 of the Constitution makes that very clear. And you know that in terms of Section 172 of the Constitution, courts are obliged to declare any law that is inconsistent with the Constitution inconsistent, any law or conduct. So the courts have no discretion to do that. They are obliged to do so. And that makes a fundamental difference. Now, whether it is the executive conduct or conduct consistent with the law, see, you've heard the thesis that the executive has some kind of cushioning against the Constitution. But our Constitution makes it clear that all conduct, whether it is conduct by the executive or not, whether the conduct is a result of executive policy or not, once executive policy gives rise to conduct, that conduct is inconsistent with the Constitution, and the court has no right to do otherwise but to consider it and declare it inconsistent with the Constitution. So that is a fundamental respect in which the separation of powers has changed. The separation of powers has also changed because courts have been given more power in terms of this Constitution than have been given in others. It changed because we have social and economic rights in our Constitution. In the old days, the argument used to be that these are multi-pronged executive decisions which courts are not empowered to make. And yet our Constitution has given the courts the power to determine whether the state has taken, in a particular instance, reasonable legislative and other measures within its available resources to ensure the progressive realization of the social and economic rights described in Section 26 and 27, which are, as you know, the right to health, social welfare, housing, and so on. Okay? So that does affect it because it is the Constitution which gives the court the power to go deeply into things and look at social and economic rights. And finally, what has made an impact on the separation of powers in our country is the idea that courts have adopted the thesis of rationality, which many administrative lawyers disagree with, because it has made administrative law and the concept of reasonableness in admin law and so on a little bit irrelevant. They're just afraid that maybe the admin law department at universities might close down, but that's a slightly different issue. What courts have done is they said everything that all exercise of public power must be rational. And once exercise of public power is irrational, that is the end of the matter. And what our courts have done, to the chagrin and criticism of many academics, but as far as I'm concerned, it was right to do so, to naturally expand the principle of rationality so that more things are caught within it and the government power is susceptible to more control, which I think is... So it's now become unnecessary. If once something is irrational, it's impossible, it's unnecessary to decide whether it's administrative action or not. And therefore that whole field of law begins to suffer, because what courts do is they say, this is irrational, and therefore I don't need to go into the question of whether this is admin action or not. So that too has broadened the court's power a great deal and has impacted on the separation of powers. What this means, of course, is that there is no fixed, static definition of the separation of powers. The separation of powers was not what somebody said 100 years ago. The separation of powers is a dynamic, dynamic term whose definition changes and whose definition is not dependent on some international theoretical wisdom of 100 years ago or some international theoretical wisdom of today. What it is that it is wholly dependent on the instrument, the constitutional instrument that we are dealing with. So the constitutional, the separation of powers in England would be judged one way. The separation of powers in the US would be something different, because it is based on their constitution, and the separation of powers in our country is based on our constitution. So I think that courts have to intervene. There is a sense in which you do raise a problem, because there are two bases on which you could be saying that it is unfortunate that political battles are being transferred to the courts. You could be making the point, and we can engage in that debate if all of you wish, you could be making the point that it is the judges who must be careful and refrain from going into these political things. That point of view, I would disagree with completely and absolutely, because it is judges' duty in terms of the Constitution to determine the constitutionality or otherwise of law or conduct. So if your question implies that this is a problem of the judiciary or a problem of the Constitution, I would disagree with you completely. Whose fault is it that a judge had to decide in Kandla? The reason why the court had to decide whether our president has to pay in Kandla is because we have a shifty, dishonest president. So it is the dishonesty of the president in that regard and his basic hooliganism as far as that aspect of the matter was concerned, which forced the court to act. So if by your question you mean, are politicians beginning to behave so unreasonably, unfortunately so, and our service providers behaving so irresponsibly, and is the corruption so rampant in our society, unfortunately, that the courts are unfortunately have to do their job. The society we want is a society in which people are reasonable with each other. Nkandla wouldn't have had to go to court if Jacob Zuma had paid long ago, or if the idiotic thing hadn't happened in the first place. And you look at every case that the courts have had to handle, where some person has lost and others have won, you find that one or other party have acted utterly unreasonably in the process, and most parties want to use the court to delay things, to make their position better, and to legally glorify things. But that is not the fault of the court or the constitution, because if we didn't have that, the corruption in our society would be absolutely rampant. What we need is a more reasonable, careful attitude on the part of politicians, on the part of service providers, on the part of every human being in the country. And I would like, I'd like to see an ideal society, even if one of you is accused of assault. If you did it, I would like to admit, be in a society where you say, I'm sorry, I did it and I was wrong. But denial becomes such an amazing thing in our society, by human being, by politicians, even by lawyers, by service providers. Everything has to be proved, everything has to be done technically, because our society needs a fundamental reshuffle. And that is the kind of change we should be pushing for in our society. So I'll stop there. It was a long answer to a simple question. But maybe we could discuss it a little more, or maybe somebody wants to raise another issue.
Are there any other issues to be raised? Shard, yes?
Hello. My name is Shard. I'm a fourth year
student. So you're more senior than the other guy. Your question should be more intelligent, right?
Oh.
Let me tell you about that. Have all of you got Section 25 in front of you? You can't come to a talk like this without bringing a copy of the Constitution with you. So how can I talk to you properly? All right. So I'll try and manage. But next time, you go to listen to anybody talking about anything on the Constitution, take it with you, right? Is that a fair deal? If you promise that you'll take it with you in the future, I'll deal with the question now. Okay?
Promise.
We've got a deal. Okay. Okay. Excellent. So firstly, we had negotiations in our country. We had negotiations not because F.W. de Klerk suddenly got it into his heart that this apartheid thing was so miserable and so horrible. He felt pangs of conscience and so on. And he decided that something had to be done about it. Nor did we have a constitutional negotiation because the ANC suddenly felt that maybe the Nats have something to offer and something to say which we should listen to as a matter of moral conscience. We had negotiations in 1994, and those negotiations, like the time when the German constitution was formed, were directly impacted upon by the balance of forces that existed at the time. And the balance of forces were that the international pressure was rising against this country a great deal, which was a very important thing. Secondly, the country was becoming ungovernable, and the National Party was unable to govern the country properly. On the other side of the coin, the problem was that the physical army of this country was so well equipped and so strong that the chances of the ANC conquering them absolutely and completely and immediately was very, very far away. And we in the ANC, and I was part of the ANC then, I'm very proud to say I'm not now, but we realized that we couldn't get that absolute victory, okay? I'm just giving you a simple account of those balance of forces which I think you need to understand. Okay, so we had to have negotiations because the ANC couldn't win, the Nats couldn't win, and therefore both of them were forced to talk to each other. De Klerk was forced to talk because of the balance of forces that existed at the time, and so was the ANC, and all of them had to take into account the balance of forces. So, let's look at the balance of forces and the property clause and the international arena as it stood then. If we proposed a clause which said that we must be able to take property Mugabe style in this country and the constitution must authorize it, which some people are saying must take place, we would never have settled. The army would still have been in place. The government, the apartheid government, because of the interests it had to protect, would never, never, ever have said yes to that. We'd probably never have got the vote. We'd probably never have got our constitution. And that is the essence of negotiation. So it was not realistic at all for us to make that demand. Our international thing would have fallen absolutely and completely. But more importantly, many of us believed that you can't rewrite history like that. Many of us believed in the rule of law, and many of us believed in the balance. In the balance that the Constitution had to achieve, and the possibilities of the Constitution to allow reconstruction in the future in a particular way, and not necessarily the immediate transfer of property. Okay? So let's see in that context what Section 25 provided. I'm looking at it now, and that's why I have a problem that most of students and so on make comments about sellout of the property clause and so on, when you haven't looked at it. And I'm prepared to bet that many of you have very strong views about the property clause, but you haven't looked at it. So let's now look at it. So the Constitution doesn't confer a right to property. Subsection 1 says, no one may be deprived of property except in terms of law of general application, and no law may permit the arbitrary deprivation of property. That, although it does not confer the right to property, means that nobody's property is ever going to be taken away arbitrarily. But remember that this is the first part of the clause, and you cannot look at the clause in isolation, okay? So let me show you the balance. Subsection 2 provides for expropriation and says property may only be expropriated in terms of a law of general application for a public purpose or in the public interest, and subject to compensation, and listen to this very carefully, property may be expropriated subject to compensation, the amount of which and the time of manner and payment of which has either been agreed to by those affected or decided or approved by a court. So the government is not even, when it expropriates property for public purposes, obliged to pay for it in cash. The timing and the manner of payment and the amount of compensation must be determined by a court. And then subsection 3 talks about the amount of compensation. The amount of the compensation and the time and the manner of payment must be just and equitable. Not market value, must be just and equitable, reflecting an equitable balance between the public interest, which you have spoken about, and the interest of those affected, having regard to all relevant circumstances, including, and the value is supposed to be determined by all the relevant circumstances, not by market value, including the current use of the property, the history of the acquisition and use of the property. So if they got the property in unfair and improper circumstances, and the property is being not being put to proper use, that would be taken into account in the determination of the amount payable. Three, the market value of the property. D, the extent of direct state investment and subsidy in the acquisition and beneficial capital improvement of the property. So if the state had made a contribution, you can take that into account. And E, the purpose of the expropriation. So these are all the factors which had to be taken into account as far as the constitution was concerned to determine appropriate compensation. And the idea was that to effect change and to effect a redistribution of the property, the state would charge the rich more taxes, and mainly those people would be white. We would determine just and equitable compensation, and property transfers would take place in relation to other provisions of the Constitution, which I will come to, okay? But what did our government do? You think they changed the expropriation law to provide for compensation, just and equitable compensation, so that they could save money and make sure that more property was expropriated to make sure that we got this right balance? And we had more and more African people getting property in this country. Nothing of the sort. Our government, in its wisdom, from 19 and to the great joy of property owners and business and those political parties who support them, continued to pay market value. Now, if I even speculate on the reason why government continued this, I will be committing a defamatory act. But I will leave it at asking you just one question. If we assume that market value will be higher than just an equitable compensation in terms of the Constitution, as I think we can assume, then where is the greater scope for certain people to benefit improperly from these transactions? Market value deals or just and equitable deals? So I want to say that the Constitution made this provision. Then in subsection 5, the Constitution says the state shall take reasonable, legislative, and other measures within its available resources to foster conditions which enable citizens to gain access to land on an equitable basis. And there's much legislation in relation to which the court has, our country has done that. It has certainly not gone far enough, but there is legislation to that effect. And then subsection 6, and this is a very important part. We have to think about how far back to go to restore property or compensate people who are disadvantaged with property. We know that the theft of property started in 1652. I would imagine the very day on which Van Riebeek landed here. But we could not, you can't rewrite history 300-400 years back. So there was a lot of negotiation and hard-fought negotiation about how far we should go. And we decided during the negotiations that 1913 was the right date, because 1913 was the first time when we had an actual law, the Land Act, which reinforced the division of land and how the land transactions went. So we decided it is impossible to rewrite history without breaking the country down completely and absolutely. The country still had to run, it still had to go, people had to be safe within it, and so on and so on. So subsection 6, which none of you have seen, provides that a person or community whose tenure of land is legally insecure as a result of past racially discriminatory laws or practices is entitled, to the extent provided by an Act of Parliament, either to tenure which is legally secure or to comparable redress. And there is an Act of Parliament which provides for that in relation to farm tenants and so on, which was aimed at ensuring tenure. Then subsection 7, a person or community dispossessed of property after 19 June 1913, which was the date on which the Constitution was passed. So a person or community dispossessed of property after 19 June 1913, as a result of past racially discriminatory laws or practices, is entitled, to the extent provided by an Act of Parliament, either to restitution of that property or to equitable redress. Again, the idea was that people who were deprived of property as a result of past discriminatory practices before 1913 would get either property or would get compensation. So we couldn't rewrite history completely. There were lots of provisions, and the choice was made that we're not going to take the law into our own hands. We're not going to grab other people's property for nothing. Because if you do that, it becomes the survival of the fittest or the survival of the strongest. It becomes warfare. And if the one side fights, and the other side begins to fight back, you must just understand that we are going to have the kind of mayhem in this country which we will not be able to accept. So it may be that the property clause needs to be changed a little bit more. It may be that this government must ensure that it enforces the Constitution properly and make sure that it does the thing properly. But I think that we have a property conversion regime which the government has not applied properly, which gives us a great deal of opportunity to move property gradually. And I'm telling you this, that if we had moved the property in terms of what the Constitution has provided and using the right constitutional premises, 2% every year, we would have been 50% of the way there now, and we'd have been there in another 25 years or 30 years. I think even if we start moving that property by 2 or 3% every year, we'll be there in 30 or 40 years. But we need that planning, we need that care, we need that commitment. We do not need violent seizure of property and that sort of thing and that complication. And that is why I think, firstly, that the Constitution gives us scope to transform things and change them. And of course, the sad thing is that now that the Constitution, the ANC wants to change the Constitution in terms of the property, I'd like to ask them, for some very strange reason, the DA doesn't want it because it's relying on those interests. I'd love to ask the DA why and maybe some of you should ask them when you see them, because everybody is fighting in terms of their own needs. Why do they say that the law should not be brought in line with Section 25 of the Constitution? And if I were a political party in this country, I would say that is the route to transformation which we must follow aggressively and quickly. So that is the long answer again on the property clause and where we go as far as that's concerned. And I'd like to hear some criticism of that, please, so that I can answer it.
Some criticism or issues with
someone else's chance to answer, otherwise I
would. Shah, do you have some feedback on your question?
Nothing in the line of criticism. There was very beautiful exposition and very informative.
But you should have read it beforehand, right? Right. As long as you agree with me on that, because as law students, you must read these things. Anyway, yes. I agree, but our constitution allows for that radical transformation gradually happening. Only the ANC, for its own reasons, decided not to operationalize it.
Yes, Judge, so my question is, if we accept constitutionally, or at least in terms of principle, Section 25 gets it right,
Yeah.
And you seem to then place the fault of the slow change of land distribution on the failure on the part of the executive or the legislature to realize the vision of the constitution.
Yeah.
I'm interested in your opinion on the new expropriation act. So it's not been signed into law yet, as far as I'm aware, but there are very differing views on that. I'm interested in your opinion.
Again, this is my fault. I've been accusing you of not reading the constitution properly. I have had a very quick look at the amendments to the expropriation. That seems to me to be fine. It seems to me to go a long way towards making it happen, but I haven't sat down long and hard and thought about every word. But my sense is that it's definitely in the right direction. My sense is that opposition to it is quite wrong.
Any more questions? And to everyone who just joined us, a big welcome. And this is an open engagement, so you're free to ask any questions should you have for Justice Yacoob.
Yeah, so Justice, seeing some of the work that Siri does, and now with Marikana going to court, what is your opinion on negligent landowners? Like, I know we talk a lot here about land and expropriation of land, but if you have a case where a landowner has just been negligent, and over 7 years, people have made it their home, and then to come and try to evict 600,000 people.
I think that A, landowners should not be negligent, but B, that land could very easily be expropriated if we had the will to do so and if we applied the right approach. Because remember that one of the things to determine just and equitable compensation is the use to which the land is being put. And really the constitutional thinking is that if people use their land, then obviously they must be allowed to use it. If they're negligent and they let it go idly, it'll be one factor, if the new constitutional mechanism was applied, which would have a huge impact on what the state paid, because property is of the nation. And I don't think in our constitutional state people can be allowed to have hectares and hectares of land which they don't use and which they keep for the future. If you don't use it, you lose it at the level that it has an impact on the price you get paid for it. If you are using it, of course, then the use to which you put it to gives you a price. But land has value in terms of use. And this utter capitalist notion of the value of things in themselves is really a money-making notion which we ought to reject with the contempt it deserves.
Another question?
Have we settled the land debate? I don't think we'll ever settle the land debate.
No, but I'd like someone to oppose my approach if they want to. And tell me how they think it's going to happen. Let's have the debate.
And bravely do so, yeah.
It'd be lovely to talk about it. I'd love to see how you see it happening. You must have an idea. You've got to have an idea. You can't say this thing is wrong. You've got to be able to say, this is how I would do it. And I'm telling you, the way you do it is you have all these provisions in a constitution and the government moves at it with rapidity. People will get hurt, people will get injured as a result of it. There'll be lots of complaints at the payment of low prices and all sorts of things. But it is infinitely better than violently taking away land from people, which is something I will never agree to. I might as well die than agree to that.
Fadi?
So I'll make a devil's advocate argument. Typically, the backlash you see against even just expropriation in general, but also new legal developments in expropriation, from example, agri-SA also, is specifically in relation to agricultural land. The argument many make is that if you have such extensive or radical expropriation that it has a severe detriment on the economy. So this is not my opinion, this is the general opinion that you...
No, it is some opinion. It's not too general. I mean, the jury is out on that, isn't it?
So my question is, how do you think that So if we accept...
Look, the answer is quite simple. I think people must manage these things quite carefully. I agree that there have been instances in which land has been, which was properly used, has been expropriated and handed over to communities without any trading and so on, and that land has not been used, it's not benefited those communities, and the communities have remained as dissatisfied as ever. That's what you call a useless, counterproductive transfer of land. And I would agree that no person in their right mind should effect that kind of transfer. There have, of course, been other transfers of land which have worked well, and I think that what the government needs to do is to go very carefully into investigating. See, when you do things, you do make mistakes. What people don't do is go back and investigate that carefully. Now, I'm quite sure that from our 20 years of experience, somebody will be able to draft a wonderful paper, a master's thesis, on which expropriations and transfers of land have succeeded and which not, and why, and what is the correct route to go. There's a lot of information on which you can do. But I agree completely that expropriation and transfer of land, rural land, is not to be lauded for its own sake, in the same way as ownership of property is not to be lauded for its own sake. And therefore, I would agree completely that the transfers of land must actually be very, very carefully managed. And we mustn't do things in name, we must do them for real. I agree with that completely.
Justice, I was wondering if I could then ask a very different question and a slightly more personal question. And because I would like to know more about your experiences as a justice in the Constitutional Court, particularly being a blind justice in the Constitutional Court. How have your experiences been navigating that world?
No, I mean, by the time I became a judge in the Constitutional Court, I think I had conquered blindness and learnt ways in which to manage it, because remember that I was blind from the time I was 16 months old. I had been to a school for the blind. I had been in practice as an advocate and a reasonably successful practice for years. I'd been a part of the underground of the African National Congress and so on. And because I was already highly regarded when I went to the bench, I could ask for anything and I got it. So I had to be, so what did I have? I had an extra qualified PA who got paid more than the PAs of the other judges had. They had a car specially allocated to me, and I had this PA to fetch me from work, take me to and from work. So I didn't have to, like many blind people, have to take buses and taxis and get my wife to drive me, which can give rise to its own complications sometimes. So that's what I had. Then I had a gadget like this, which is Braille, which I can read here, which very few people in this country have, which costs about 80,000 rand. It came out in 2002, and the court bought it for me. And when I went to the court, they gave me a talking computer immediately, the very best, which talked to me and so on and so on. They bought a printer worth 500,000 rand, so that I had printed Braille, which school children don't have these days, and that's one of the complaints, which university students blind don't have these days because the printing facilities are so bad. I had an excellent printing person, I had an excellent printer, I had everything under my fingertips. So I must say that as far as reasonable accommodation is concerned, I was mercifully over accommodated, and my life as a blind person was not a trouble at all at that level. That being said, there is one respect in which blindness is a serious disadvantage, which is that you can only read things as fast as your fingers can move over words, or as fast as a voice can intelligibly say it to you. And therefore, I think my daughter has probably read, although she is 26 years younger than I am, or 25 years or something, she's probably read 3 times as much as I have. I'm sure many of you have read 3 or 4 times more than I have. But it takes longer to read record and to read argument and so on and so on. So the only trouble as far as the blindness thing was concerned, and because I was fastidious and I had to know everything before I went into a court and so on and so on. The long hours, I mean, I had to work 18, 19, 20 hours a day consistently to be able to do this job properly.
Thank you, Justice. Any more questions? Yes.
I'm from the disability unit here at the university. Mm-hmm. So
do you produce good Braille?
Do we? Well, we produce Braille, and we also, students are more and more using electronic, like the screen reading software.
Well, it'd be nice. It'd be very nice if there's a printed program for this tonight's session. If you could give it to me in Braille, I'd love to evaluate it. Okay, and I'll make a comment to you about it afterwards. That's fine, yeah.
We have someone who's qualified in reading Braille, so she'll be able to, QC that. But I was just wondering, you've had all the, you've had like the Rolls Royce in terms of support out in the workplace. We know that there is a target put on workplaces, I think it's 2%.
So sorry, you're speaking too fast and too...
Of people where they have to be disabled in the workplace.
Yeah.
And it seems like workplaces are really struggling with that, I think at universities, that our provision of support is sort of quite unequal across universities and even schools. You're looking at inclusive schools, they're supposed to be able to accommodate for each and every disability. So
yeah,
that's quite a huge challenge. So what we find is that many of our students finishing off at university and to go into the workplace are quite challenging in terms of accessibility. So from transportation, they don't necessarily get the PAs to take them to work. Transportation systems not always very safe, so they're very restrained and restricted in terms of access out there. So they become really comfortable in the Stellenbosch environment because they know their way around. So, and we sometimes get companies, saying to us, oh, we're looking for students with graduates with disabilities, but we only want this disability and that disability. So it's really difficult for us to also advise students and to, point them in the right direction, because it seems that companies are also quite choosy. And I think it's because of resources, having to provide someone to do transportation for someone in the workplace and all the facilities. So, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are and what support companies to
you see, that is perhaps a very complicated question, but let me see what I can do. The first problem is that you can't paint disability with one broad brush. So if someone is on a wheelchair and every other movement and the brain and the emotions and so on are working fine, it's an easy question, because then the only accommodation you need is lifts, you need accessible places, and once a person gets to their workplace accessibly, that's the only accommodation you need. And once you've got that person to their desk or where they've got to work with their hands, their eyes and their ears and so on and their brains, everything works perfectly. No problem. That is one thing. If you have a blind person, then that you can't. If you give the blind person the assistance that you would give a deaf person, it is just useless to the blind guy. Because you talk to a blind guy in sign language, the blind guy won't see it. Okay? So for blind people, you need Braille, which deaf people and hard of hearing people don't need. You need mobility and orientation training, which blind, which deaf and hard of hearing people don't need. You need a teaching skill, if the person is at university, to explain things and not necessarily put pictures before blind people and partially sighted people in the hope that they will understand. But to deaf people, the pictures will work wonderfully well. If you have a deaf person, you need hearing aids, loop, sign language. If you have a deaf blind person, it's a different thing. So what we've been doing is, under the guise of inclusion and the broad painting of the brush in relation to disability, we've been trying to answer these questions. So you will find that employers have a bloody good idea about which, in respect of which disability, they will need less accommodation, it will cost them less, and which disability it will cost them more. And blindness costs a lot more, and they're not going to do it in this day and age, because as wonderful as capital might be, it hasn't developed those sympathies yet, except the exceptional business person here and there. So we need a different approach to them. So I think the answer is that you've got to have the resources to develop in the particular circumstances, not under a broad brush of disability. Because dealing with a blind person in the university is one thing, dealing with a deaf person is another, dealing with a person on a wheelchair is the third, dealing with a deaf blind person at a university is another. And no single person can have the expertise to deal with all of that. And I don't even think that there is a complete understanding of what the expertise are that are required. So I would suggest that disability units of your kind must work very closely. You should have specialists dealing with each area, otherwise you're not going to manage. And if your vice chancellor doesn't see that, there's a bit of a problem on your hands, because there are different things which you've got to work on differently. You've got to develop your expertise. You've got to use local organizations of people with disability to help you develop your expertise. And of course, you've got to start learning from the people with disability themselves how to manage them, because what we say these days quite often is nothing about us without us. So it's going to be a hard job. You're going to have to train, you're going to have to learn, you've got to make sure that you do PR work amongst employers and so on. And employment of people with visual disability is the biggest thing in the world. I work as the president of the KwaZulu-Natal Blind and Deaf Society, and it is very, very, very difficult to go out there. It's easy for people to talk the talk, but once you ask them to put their money where their mouths are, all the excuses start coming. I tell you, I went to look for articles when I wanted to be an attorney. So after I left university, I was a young man. I thought I knew everything. The world was my oyster. I went to about 35 or 40 attorneys looking for articles. And everyone said to me, "You're such a wonderful chap. I tell you, my heart goes out to you. You have been so brilliant at the university, you know. And really, our admiration for you knows no bounds," and so on. Big, long speech. "If only we had space, we would take you tomorrow. Unfortunately, we have no space." And I knew that all of them were lying. There's no way out of that. And then I became an advocate because I couldn't get articles. And then those attorneys had to come and wanted to brief me, because they learned that I was a good advocate. And I said to each of them, not as fast as that. And I got at least 20 of them to admit to me that they lied and to apologize before I was prepared to do their work. So it's quite a complete, and you see, the problem is that you get exceptional people like me who can fight their way through things and have the necessary impertinence and so on to push people around. And I do sometimes push people around too much. That's the bad side of this personality which I have developed, right? So there is a downside, and my wife and children will tell you all about it. It's quite a difficult downside, but it is a downside, which is there. But you can't measure the extent to which society is dealing with people with disability appropriately by pointing to exceptions. We have to make sure that the average student at the university who has a disability, not the exceptional ones who have their own style and class, and 5% of them are like that, they will somehow make it despite you, not because of you, and they will teach you how to do it. You've got to make sure that the run-of-the-mill student with disability get through society appropriately and properly. You've got to make sure that the blind and partially sighted, and blind mainly, African and colored person or colored person living in a deep rural area with no food, no money, no clothes, a serious disability combined with absolute poverty. How you manage those things in the country. We had a situation in one of the rural areas in KwaZulu-Natal where we had information that the relatively large blind community in that place was paying, they were all pensioners, were paying sighted pensioners 4 rand or 5 rand a time to fetch them water from the well. And the only way we could overcome that trouble is to send mobility instructors out to these areas, and we taught these people how to fetch their own water, which is something which you can't publicize in any newspaper, but which is very, very important work. So you can't judge disability work by exceptional people with disability. You've got to judge disability work with average people with disability. And I'm saying that the average people with disability who are at this university will need the support not only of the disability unit, but with all of you students who are here. You've got to develop a new attitude of inclusiveness. And if I can achieve that of heart and mind, and be a little bit more careful, more considerate, go to some extent out of your way to ensure that you empower. Not that you keep doing things for them all the time, but you make their life, you know, many people with disability, their lives are very lonely because most people with disability are not as pushy as I am to get company and so on. So you see them quiet and so on and so on. And actually, the students, I'm glad you are here and we're discussing this disability area where if you understand how blessed you are and how you can learn, you learn a lot if you put your heart out there and ensure that you begin to have meaningful relationships. It won't be one way, I promise you. A meaningful relationship with anyone with disability, it'll go both ways. But you have to make the effort. You won't believe it. Even now sometimes, I can go to somewhere and I'm standing outside with lots of people having tea. Hardly anyone will come and talk to me for two reasons. A, I don't make eye contact. and secondly, maybe they're a bit afraid that I'm a retired judge or something. But most blind people have that problem. You're standing somewhere in one corner. Now, you don't know where to move and what to do. There's nobody with you. It can become a complication. So, yeah. Sorry, long answer to the disability question. But that is also an important part of my life, and I was glad to talk about it.
Thank you. Anyone else with further questions? Fadi's left short.
I have lots of questions, but I don't want to take up the conversation. So
shall we see if anyone else has some more questions?
If other people have questions, I prefer that other people ask because I've had my chance.
All right. Yes.
How do we ensure that people are informed of the law? Of course, you
Okay, that's a very important question, which goes to the issue I raised about the disconnect between our society and the Constitution, right? So if you look at our Bill of Rights, if all of you look at it, the 39, 40 clauses, simply written, easy to read. I still read sections of the Bill of Rights because I think, and I look at the values it entails. I have been saying, for example, to many universities, and I'm saying it here, and let's hope that somebody is listening, that the Bill of Rights should be part of the orientation course of the university for all university students, not only for lawyers, not only for law students, not only for constitutional law students. Each and every one of us should know our Bill of Rights, should know the values of our Bill of Rights, should know what our Bill of Rights means, and we should each and every one of us embrace those values and start living those values. And that, guys, has nothing to do with the law. That has to do with you and all other students. You read that Bill of Rights, everybody can understand it. It's not a legalese document. The property clause may be one of the most complex of them all. But the right to dignity and the right to freedom of association and the right to equality and all those things are important values which people must embrace, understand, and live by. And then you start propagating those values to other people, even people in the street. How many times do we hear at our dinner tables, and I don't expect you to make any admissions in this regard, or when we go to a wedding or something, racist comments, sexist comments, and so on. How many times do male students get together and have comments which amount to sexism in the highest extreme and so on? And those are the arenas where we need to work very hard, because the ordinary person, when you understand and internalize the values of the Constitution, and once you start living them, you can convey them to an ordinary person, not through law, but through your own adjusted humanity as you have done it through the Constitution. Constitutional Court says gay and lesbian people must be able to get married. 95% of our people say gay and lesbian people live in sin. That's a disconnect. So, whatever religion you belong to, you've got to try and achieve, examine your own consciences and achieve equality in that direction. Because can you expect other people to treat you with dignity and care and equally if you want to be contradictory and you're not able or prepared to fight for other people's right to dignity? Can a woman say she must be treated equally and don't care whether African people are treated equally or not at the level of race? So it is one big equality struggle. And then quite often we are our own oppressors. There are many women I know who would justify their own oppression. They say, I'm not oppressed. I do all these things for my husband, and I do these things in the kitchen, and I don't work, and all, because I actually love to do it. And that is an indication of how oppressed they really are. Julius Malema once said, he goes to a white lawyer because he actually thinks white lawyers are better. Everybody laughed at him. Truth of the matter is that not only Julius Malema goes to a white lawyer, Ramaphosa goes to a white lawyer, many, many people in the corporates go to a white lawyer, and black lawyers, generally speaking, subject to exception, get the dregs from all over the world. So ultimately, those values yet have not changed. And there are many people, and if you think about it carefully yourself, you too will realize sometimes that in your heart somewhere you think you are superior or you think someone else is superior. I had that problem. And I had to examine myself very carefully. It was very easy to shout non-racialism and non-sexism, right? But it's harder in your heart of hearts to live those values. Very, very much more difficult. I must say, I found non-racism easy. I found non-sexism and leading a completely non-sexist life very difficult. I sort of got there. But on that one, I still have to watch myself, because there's still a small chance, even at this age, that I might slip into sexist conduct at one level or another. So badly is this thing ingrained. So the first step is for us to think carefully and convert ourselves. Because if we don't do that, and don't worry about it, if you find the sexism and the racism in your heart somewhere, just think that when I was your age, I was there. And the important thing is change it and move forward. So over and above the constitutional revolution, we need a social revolution. We need to change the hearts and minds of people. Lawyers are the first people who can do it. Not two lawyers. Because one of the things we have to do as lawyers in the struggle is to explain laws, oppressive laws, and to tell people how to avoid them and what to do. And the so-called lay people you talk about, if you handle them carefully and if you talk to them properly, you will find that they have a richness to offer in their response which you absolutely never foresaw. The bottom line is the law can't cut it. We need a social revolution. We need a change in the hearts and minds of all our people. And it starts with us and how we learn the Constitution, how we learn to live its values, how we persuade others, and how the world slowly but surely begins to change. And remember, this racism and sexism is not only here. The Americans and the Brits are worse at that level, to a great degree. Okay, any more?
Justice, I think on that note, we're going to start wrapping up.